Welcome to Freedive Live with Ted Harty, episode number 11. I'm the founder of Immersion Freediving, as well as my new pride and joy, freedivingsafety.com. If you've not visited freedivingsafety.com, here's why you should. It's an online resource that goes over the risks of the sport, covers the truth about blackout, goes over the fatality numbers. I don't sugarcoat anything. You're going to learn how to tell if you're overweighted, if you're breathing in such a way that would increase your risk for blackout, and most importantly, if your buddy has a loss of motor control or blackout, how do you save them? Like, what are you supposed to do, right? So you can access all of that whenever you want. It's free, right? I want anyone who is smart enough to understand that that is information that they should have to be able to access that information, right? So you can see that all at freedivingsafety.com. So for those of you that are tuning in, do me a favor. It also lets me know the comments are working. Just put in the comments, let me know where you're from and if you're a freediver or a spearfisherman. Another thing I'm going to be doing on this episode moving forward, which I'm excited about, is I'm going to, when the show is over, I'm going to put a link to a questionnaire. So the questionnaire is going to cover, basically just ask some questions about you guys, like, where are you from? Are you a freediver? Are you a spearfisherman? What are your interests? And I think the question that is most important, one that hopefully you'll be interested in, is what do you want me, what's your favorite part of the show is one of the questions, and what do you want me to discuss, right? Like, if you could make me, what do you want to hear, right? So basically I'm trying to ask you guys that watch the show, what do you want? So I'll be looking at that. What I will do for your consideration to take the time to go take that survey is I will mail, if you live in the United States, and you fill out the survey, the last question will have you, you can fill in your address, and I'll ship you out some freedivingsafety.com stickers, which are brand new and no one has. So the plan for today, and so excuse me, my voice is a little scratchy. I've been sick all week. That's why I didn't run any episodes on Monday or Tuesday, but I should be good to go for the show today. I had a lot of technical issues with the software I'm using last week. I figured out how to remedy all that. So I'm excited because next week I'm going to start trying to do the interviews, learn how to make that work. So I'm excited to start getting some guests on the show. All right, so today's show, I'll be going over just a quick piece of gear advice. I'll be going over the snorkel keeper, the lowly snorkel keeper, what you want to pay attention to when you're looking at those. And then the other thing I'll be discussing is how and why you should hunt in teams when you're spearfishing. And more importantly, I'm going to show you three examples of how you would put more fish in the cooler if you were hunting in a team versus if you're hunting as individuals. Right. So the snorkel keeper. So this is what a traditional snorkel keeper looks like, right? This comes in every snorkel, almost every snorkel you'll buy, you're going to see this little thing right here, right? And as soon as you get this snorkel keeper, you take it and throw it away, right? These are no good, right? What you want is the figure eight snorkel keeper. This is my favorite one. It is really thick. So this way it's thick, right? That way it's thick this way. It's super soft and so it's stretchy and it's really sticky, right? So this is my favorite snorkel keeper. You're gonna see some that are like this. It's gonna be hard for you to tell the difference, but what I can tell you is this one, this black one, it's a lot thinner. It's not nearly as sticky, and I find what these do is they tend to dry out, so then this thing just becomes solid and the snorkel, it'll fly it out of it. So that's why you want the really stretchy ones like this. And these clear ones tend to do best. Excellent, spearfisherman, Austin. I'm not gonna go through it all again because I just did on the last episode, but for those of you that are watching this episode that did not watch episode 10, I did an entire, went over two tips with the snorkel. So I get into how to set these, use these snorkel keepers to set up your snorkel so that you get a lot of extra height out of the water. And I also showed you how to change the angle of the snorkel, all of that, so that you can get your snorkel, you know, 3, if not more, inches out of the water, so you're getting a lot less water to snorkel. So wherever you're watching this, on Facebook, Twitter, whatever, you can just go back. The old episodes are still online. You can watch episode number 10, and you'll go over how to do that. All right. So, again, for those of you that are in there, let me know where you're from, if you're freediver, spearfisherman. I'm always trying to figure that out. And if you have questions for me. So as I go through the show, at the end of the show, when I'm done covering everything, I will answer any question you guys have. So if you have those, put them in the comments, and I will go through and address those. All right. So I did a talk last Thursday, where I went down to the South Florida Freedivers, big spearfishing club down in Miami. They had me do a presentation on safety. I've probably done 3, if not 4 there over the past 4 years. And they asked me to talk about one specific thing. Freediving safety as it pertains to spearfishing. And so I was happy to go down there. It was really cool. Absolutely, it's my job. So I went down to these guys, South Florida Freediver. I did a presentation on safety. And so one of the things I always joke about in my class is when I'm teaching the safety portion of my class, I always joke that whether I go to a spearfishing club or maybe I'm at a presenting at the Blue Wild, which is coming up not this weekend but next weekend. It's the largest freediving spearfishing trade show in the United States. It's here in Fort Lauderdale. I've been a featured speaker there, I believe, 4 or 5 years in a row. And I always joke in class that however I get there, a room full of spearfishermen, and I, mention that, you need to be hunting in teams and watching your buddy, right? And it's not like when I tell them that, I tell them you need to be hunting one up, one down, right? One person's down, the other person stays at the surface, whose sole focus is to be at the surface when that guy comes, and then close enough to grab and watch him. And so when I tell, this group of spearfishermen, they should do that. It's not like they go, "Oh my God, that's an amazing idea. I've never heard of such an idea. I will immediately start doing that tomorrow. Like absolutely tomorrow for sure. I mean, that's brilliant. That's brilliant." No, they all know they're supposed to do that. They just don't wanna, right? They're like, "But I'm not gonna do that," right? And that's why we have the fatality rate that we have, right? It's just normal. I was given the presentation at the South Florida Freedivers, and this one guy's like, "Yeah, but no one does that." And I'm like, "Yeah, that's why you guys, there's so many fatalities." I'm like, you used to not wear seatbelts, but you do now because people realize that it's stupid not to wear a seatbelt, right? Because you don't want to die if you get in a wreck. Now, let's look at the reasons why, some of the reasons I hear over the years that spearfishermen don't want to dive in teams. One of them is... Well, there's one thing that they'll say, and there's one thing that they won't say. But one thing that they'll say is, my buddy, he'll scare the fish. He'll scare the fish. Okay. Maybe in very specific situations, and if your buddy's a complete idiot, maybe that could happen. But I would argue that most of the times, that's not going to be an issue. I mean, let's put it this way. Have you ever noticed when you make a drop, and you're going down, and let's say you get to the bottom at 60 feet, that the fish tend to scatter, right, when you get there, right? Because they sense that you're coming. They can feel that you're down there, but you're not sneaking up on them, right? That's why they scatter like that, right? Compare how much noise, how that is to, someone going down on the fish and they all scatter, to your buddy who's 60 feet up there sitting there not doing anything. Like, if you compare the two, there's no comparison, right? I mean, so I in most circumstances, I don't buy that the buddy is scaring off the fish, right? I think the biggest reason, they might not say this, but I certainly believe that it is, the spearfisherman, like, they go to their spot, right? The spearfisherman says, "All right, this area right here, this is where all the big fish are, right? Because I know this area, this is my spot, right? This area from here to here to here, my area, this is where all the big fish are. You go way the hell over there where all the tiny fish are." Right, and so because they don't want you near them because you're going to shoot their fish, right? So it's that competitiveness, in my mind, among spearfishermen, that breeds the the unsafe culture, right? Is it's a competition, right? You know, the three guys get on the boat, and without anything saying anything, it's all about who's going to shoot the biggest fish, right? And there's competition, whether it's said or it's not. And so that's why there's such, in my opinion, there's such resistance to diving safely. So I have found over the years of, most of my customers are spearfishing in my class, and I have found over the years, oddly enough, that if I can convince either my students, whether they're spearfishermen or freedivers, whatever they are, that if I can convince them that diving my way is safe and will make them not die, I've never truly understood this, but I've been doing it long enough, I just deal with it. They don't care. That's not a good enough reason for them to change the way they dive. I go through all the stuff, and I talk about if they're overweighted, you sink down to the bottom, I talk about the fatality numbers, I show the videos of the blackouts, so you need to be diving in teams, and they're kind of like, yeah, not dying, like, whatever, like, you know, that's the way I've always done it, right? And they don't, it's not enough to change. So I've found that if I can give them examples, which you're going to hear right now, to where diving in the team will actually put more fish in the cooler than diving by yourself, then that starts making them, oh, well, maybe I will start diving in teams, right? So let's go through these, right? So basically for these examples, I'm going to create two scenarios. Scenario number one, you're diving by yourself. Now, when I say diving by yourself, I don't mean you went out on the boat and you just went out to the middle of nowhere and jumped off the boat. What I mean when I say, well, that certainly is diving by yourself. That's not exactly what I mean. The other thing I mean by diving by yourself is what most people do. Most people, 2-3 folks pull up to the spot, you anchor the boat, right? It's first thing that happens, you throw the anchor overboard. Before the anchor hits the bottom, everyone jumps off the boat like the boat's on fire, first in, first fish. This guy goes that way, this guy goes that way, this guy goes that way, this guy goes that way. Scatter, right? That's what I mean by diving by yourself, right? I mean, if you guys go over the reef and this one goes that way, this one goes that way, you're diving by yourself, right? They're not watching you on your surface. They're not close enough to do anything, right? So that's what I mean. When I say you're diving by yourself in the scenario, I just mean that no one's watching. There might be someone on the reef with you, but they're not watching you, which means they can't help you. Which is why I say it's diving by yourself. So scenario number one, you're diving by yourself. Scenario number two, you're diving in a team, right? So when you hit the surface, there's someone right there. So let's look through what would happen in these different scenarios, all right? So imagine this. You're by yourself. You make a drop. You're cruising along. You see a fish. You take a shot at the fish, and it tears off, right? Now, if you're by yourself, here's what you're kind of forced to do. You're forced to boogie on up to the surface, and now you're like, crap, I got to get back down there as fast as I can because one or two things are going to happen. Either this thing, I'm going to lose it, and it's going to swim off, and I'm not going to see it, or number two, a shark's going to get it. So I've got to get back down there as fast as I can and put a second shaft in this fish. So when you're forced to be in that situation, if you've been in this situation before, you know what you're going to do. You're going to hit the surface and you're going to start going, so you can get back down there as fast as possible, right? You may or may not know that breathing that I just did is called hyperventilation. Hyperventilation is a very dangerous style of breathing. I've talked about it in past episodes. I'm not going to go through the whole thing right now. But in essence, I'll just tell you this. When you hyperventilate like that, you are absolutely increasing the risk that you're going to black out, right? You're reducing the amount of oxygen available to your body, and you're also delaying your urge to breathe, so it makes you feel better. At the same time, you have less oxygen, right? And so that's why it increases the risk of blackout. So because you're trying to get down there really fast, you're going to be hyperventilating, and then to try to get back down there and put a second shaft in the fish. Secondly, when you go back down, which because you're going down so fast, you didn't get the time to breathe up, right? That's one of the reasons you're hyperventilating. So the downtime that you have is going to be way limited because you just did a dive, you get minimum surface interval, and you're trying to get back down again. Okay, so here's the question I always ask the spearfisherman. What is more likely in this scenario for that fish to end up in the boat? For you to be by yourself, or you hit the surface and, right, you've got a buddy right next to you. Let me tell you what Jeremy does. So Jeremy, the owner of Spearing Magazine, By the way, this is an article that I wrote for Spirit Magazine. I always say this in all these shows. If you just subscribe to Spirit Magazine, almost everything I talk about in the show, you'd already know. So what Jeremy does is he hunts specifically in three-person teams, right? Three-person teams. He's got one person diving. He's got one person on the surface watching him as the safety. And the second person is breathed up and ready to go for a situation just like this. So all Jeremy does, when he comes up to the surface, all he does is look at that guy that's open, not doing anything, he just says two. He just puts his finger like that. And that tells the guy who's on the surface, not the guy that's safety in Jeremy, the other guy who's available, put a second shaft in that fish. So that guy saw what happened, saw where the fish is, goes down, and puts a second shaft in it. Right? So here's the question. What is more likely? Right, I might be a setting that I need to change. I can't do anything about it now, but I'll look into it. What's more likely in this scenario is that you're going to put that fish in the cooler if you're by yourself, or if you've got a buddy at the surface who you just say second shot, and then he goes puts the second shaft in it, right? I've never had any other freediver or spearfisherman say anything other than, well, yeah, of course it'd be more likely if he had a buddy there. Exactly. Right? Exactly. It'd be more likely to put that fish in the cooler if you were at a person there waiting for you, right? So that's example number one. Example number two, you're making a drop. Let's say you're at 50 feet. You're cruising along the bottom, and you see a mutton snapper. Right? Actually, let's redo this. You're cruising on the bottom, and it's at the end of your breath hold, and you start to come up. Right? So you're working your way up, and you maybe do three or four kicks off the bottom, and then you see the mutton snapper. But at that point, you're like, yeah, I'm up, I'm done, right? I gotta go up, right? So you hit up the surface. Now, we got our two situations again. Scenario number one, you're by yourself, right? So what do? You're like, crap, that was a mutton snapper. Now notice what I said. I said mutton snapper, not hogfish, right? There's a hogfish, you go back to the boat, have a sandwich, come back in, take your plastic fork, and then get it, right? The hogfish is gonna be sitting there either way. Right? I didn't say hogfish, I said mutton snapper, right? If you know anything about mutton snapper, definitely a difficult fish to approach. So if you're by yourself, you're going to be at the surface and you're going, crap, I got to get down there as fast as I can to get a shot on this guy, right? So you're going to be, again, forced to hyperventilate, which is going to increase your risk for blackout. Also, because you're trying to get down there so fast, your time down there is going to be limited. Now, if you know anything, so basically what this means is you're going to get down there, you're going to feel super rushed, you're going to have not a long bottom time, and if you know anything about mutton snapper, swimming at it really fast with your gun out, trying to take a shot on it, you're not going to, like, that's the worst possible way ever to shoot a mutton snapper, right? If you do it right, you actually want to be down there with the long bottom time, maybe you can get the fish to come to you or be super slow in your movements, not running out of air, sprinting and trying to take a shot at it, right? So here's the question. Are you more likely to get that fish doing it if you're by yourself trying to do it on your own, or if you hit the surface and you say, hey, Jeff, see where that coral head was? Right past that there's a mutton snapper. Go get it. Now, you have to admit, of course, it's more obvious, it's more likely that if you've got a buddy at the surface, that fish is going to end up in the cooler if you tell your buddy where it is. But this requires an entire different mentality, because now, who's getting the fish? Not you, him, the other diver, right? So this requires a mentality shift to hunting in teams, right? The idea is, what can the team do, right? Instead of what can I do, right? As soon as you shift to teams, now the team goes out for the day, the team puts a fish in the cooler, and then you act it up. Everyone fillets the fish and everyone's got fish. One of the funniest responses I ever heard from this is I told a student this and they're like, but Ted, look, you're a damn communist, share the fish. No, that's my damn fish, right? I shot it. I'm not sharing it with anyone, right? Because, you know, spearfishermen, they put the fish on the boat and they're marking it like, this is my 17-inch, you know, this is yours is the 15-inch. You know, they make sure that when they fillet it, this is mine, this is yours, and that's fine. I get it. But if you would instead hunt as a two or three person team and see what the team can do, I've already given you two examples of where you're going to get more fish that way, right? So third example, right? Also for the guys that are watching, if you guys have questions, when I get done with this, there are a couple things I'm going to go over, and then I'm going to be doing the Q&A. Definitely my voice is, it's on the, I can hear it cracking and whatnot. So I'm probably going to make this a shorter episode. But so definitely, if you have questions, put them in the comments. And when I'm done, I will try to get to those. So third example of third scenario. So one place I know a lot of spearfishermen, at least here in Florida, they spearfish in all the time, is the Bahamas. And people are a little more on point in the Bahamas. They're much more likely to have buddies around who have eyes on them, right? And does anyone know why that is? I'm sure you can figure it out. Yes, I'm live. Yes, it's sharks, right? There's a lot of shark activity in the Bahamas, so the smart guys are going to be hunting in teams. Now, they're not maybe, they're probably mostly doing it because they're worried about sharks, less about the blackout, but whatever, either way, as long as there's someone in there. Now, one of the things that will happen is if you get a grouper and it's rocked up under one of those ledges, right, you know, now you've got to dive back down, stick your head up under this ledge and try to work this grouper out, right? And you can't see what's behind you when your head's up the ledge, right? Because you're trying to pull this grouper out. So what the smart guys are doing is they're sending the one guy down to deal with the grouper, and they're spinning a second guy down who literally is got his back, got his back. So the guy's trying to pull the fish out behind him. He's facing the other way out into the open, right? Play defense. Right, so if anyone's coming along, he's like, no, you can't go in there. Right, so you got someone playing defense. So they're good teams in that way. So here's another example. The same one, right? So you're by yourself. You shoot a grouper at 40, 50 feet, and it rocks up, and you're by yourself. If you've ever had this happen, you know exactly what's going to happen. You're going to go to the surface, and you're going to go, crap, I got to get that fish out as fast as I can, because either one, it's going to escape out the back door and I'm going to lose it, or it's going to escape out the front door and I'm going to lose it, or two, a shark's going to come get it, right? So what are you forced to do? You're like, you hit the surface, you're like, and then you go back down, right? You get, maybe 20, 30 seconds with it. Crap, can't get it. Hit the surface. And now you're like, crap, I really got to get this thing out. And then you're hyperventilating. Each time you go down, the second time you go down, you get 20 seconds. And then you just get less and less time each time you're down there because you're getting more exhausted. You're hyperventilating, you're getting less breathe up, and it just snowballs out where each dive is less and less effective. Okay, what's more likely to get that grouper out? If you hit the surface and you've got two or three guys there, and then they each just start taking turns, right, working this grouper out. I've got an amazing video, and I can't believe I forgot to have it loaded up for you guys, but I'll show it in another episode of my friend CJ Duffy from Reddit Pole Spear. He's got an awesome video, I believe they're in the Bahamas, with a grouper, and they've got like four or five guys on the surface, and this grouper is rocked up something fierce, and so you just see them one after the other, going down, working 20 seconds, they're coming up, the next one's down, and they're just keeping continual pressure on this grouper, right, and it's awesome to see, they're doing awesome teamwork. So he's a past student of mine, he's fully bought in on this idea of being safe. Yeah, Hawaiian sling only in the Bahamas, or swing or pole spear. And so what's a great part about this video is another reason I show this in every class is that one, it shows that, yes, you can hunt in teams, and here's some guys doing very well hunting in teams. But also, when CJ finally gets the grouper up, he's exhausted from all of this work. And you see him kicking up this grouper, and there's already guys kind of watching him on the way up, and he's going, I don't feel good. And he passes off the grouper, right? Because if you're not feeling good, why do you have to do the work, right? So pass it off to the guys whose legs are fresh. They grab him under the armpits because he's telling them something's not right, right? He hits the surface. He's got like three guys around him, if not four. Two guys, one under each arm. He has a little bit of loss of motor control, snaps out of it in like a second and a half, and then is like, woo, and then they're high-fiving each other, and they've got the grouper, right? They worked in teams, right? They helped pull the grouper up. He had an issue, a hypoxic issue. They were on top of it. It was a second issue, second and a half maximum, and they got the fish, right? And they were safe, and they were hunting in teams, right? So, all the old school guys are like, well, you can't hunt in teams. You could if you wanted. I mean, just because you don't want to is not the same as you can't. In most circumstances, you absolutely can hunt in teams if you wanted to. But they just don't want to, right? Which is why we have the fatality rate that we have. Okay, my most popular course that I have. So for those that are tuning in, I have a lot of online courses. Without a doubt, the most popular one that I have, and it's free. Have more people sign up for that course than any other course. It always irks me, but not surprisingly, people are much more interested in the course that increases your bottom time than teaches you how to be safe. Yeah, they don't care two squats about that safety course. They're like, whatever, that's boring. I can increase my bottom time, sign me up. How do I do it? Right, so I've got a course on how to take a 20 to 30% bigger breath, right? So the first thing students learn in my class is how to take that super big breath, right? And it's just like a car, right? If you put 20 to 30% more fuel in that car, it's gonna go 20 to 30% farther, just the way it is. If you can learn to take a bigger breath, you're gonna, you wanna increase your bottom time, you just need to take down more fuel, right? So it's a free course that will teach you how to do that. So what'll happen is when this episode is over, which is going to be sooner rather than later, the way my voice is going. I will, when the episode's done, I'm going to put links up in the post. Right now, there's no links there. But I'll put links to all the courses that I'm talking about. I'm also going to put a link to the survey for those of you that are just tuning in. I'm excited about this. I have a survey that I'm going to beg you guys to fill out. And basically, the point of the survey is I want to find out, what do you want from the show? What's your favorite part of the show? What do you wish there was more of? And I'm going to specifically ask you, what do you want to learn? What do you wish I was talking about? So I want your input on how to make the show better, because who better to ask than the people that are actually watching the show? Crazy idea, right? And I'll also, for taking the time to fill out the survey, if you live in the United States, if you live in the United States, because you're not in the United States, this doesn't work. If you live in the United States and you fill out the survey, the last question will be fill out your address. And I will ship out, I don't have them in here, the freediving safety stickers, right? So I'll send you out some of those. You can put on your fins, wherever you want. But if you take the time to do that, that's what I will do. So what I'll do is I'll go through and answer the questions when I'm done with everything. That way I'm not constantly starting and stopping. But if you guys have questions, put them in the comments. Go over the last couple things, and then I will answer your questions. Do you guys know Noob Spiro? Noob Spiro is they're an awesome podcast out of Australia. If you guys are spearfishermen, you should definitely check them out. They wrote an excellent podcast out of Australia. They've got excellent taste and guests. They've interviewed me twice, so definitely they've got good taste and guests. If you ever want to listen to the shows with me, you can find those. I did two episodes with them. I'm excited because they just signed up and joined. They're actually talking about it on their show. They're talking about it on their Facebook group. They signed up for my 28-day freediving transformation program. Right, so the program is it's basically the five most effective ways that you can train for freediving at home, right? Because I always ask the students, do you want to increase your bottom time? Do you want to feel more comfortable at depth? Do you want to, be able to hold your breath longer? And they always say yes. They never say no, they say yes. And so then I ask them, what are you currently doing to achieve those results? And your typical answer is, well, I go freediving wherever I can. And yeah, that's helpful, but it is not specific and targeted training. And that's what this program is, right? It gives you the five most effective dry land training exercises you can do at home. You're going to do it. Basically, I lay out the whole program. Every day, I tell you what to do for 28 days. You're going to do three sets of breath holding exercises a week. So you hold your breath three times, three separate days. And each breath holding exercise is different because it has a different thing that we're trying to accomplish. There's going to be some stretching exercises to make you more comfortable at depth and increase your lung volume. Basically, it takes about 2 hours a week, right? Give me 2 hours a week. You stack that for 28 days. It's an excellent thing, especially if you spend a lot of time out of the water and you don't get to dive regularly. This is a way to kind of get your dive reflex tuned up so that when you do get in the water, you're going to be rocking and rolling right off the bat. They just joined yesterday. So the other thing that's cool about the program is I have a Facebook group, that a private Facebook group you get access to. So I just got one of them in the Facebook group. And basically what the folks do every day is they post every day what exercise they're on. Day one, this is what I did. Day two, this is what I did. So it's cool. You see all the people, watching what they're doing. So I'm excited to be able to see their progress and document it. The other cool thing they did is you're going to get access to, if you sign up for the program, their ebook. They have a book called 99 Spearfishing Tips. It's an ebook that is selling for like $16 on Amazon. It's included in the program, right? It's awesome. It's got 99 spearfishing tips from people, spearfishermen all over the world. But I will be posting a link to that when I'm done, and it's normally $95. I'll give it, there'll be a coupon, Noob Spiro 28, and that'll take 15% off. And what I can tell you, for those that are thinking of that program, I'm doing a lot of work on this program, and when I get it all finished, I'm going to be raising the price about $149. That's probably going to be in 2 or 3 weeks, right? So if it's something you're interested in, I'm going to be raising it to $149. So you'll save a lot of money if you get it now. All right, so go through, see if there are any questions. If you guys have questions, put them in, because I'm going to be wrapping this thing down because my voice is starting to go. Do you have to take the free class before a normal class? No, you can take whatever courses you want. What you'll find is, I'm not exactly sure what you mean by that question when you say a normal class. I don't know if you mean like an actual in-person freediving class or if you mean my other online classes, but no, you don't have to do that. Excellent. One of the guys bought it, Michael Davis. Very cool. Glad you're enjoying it. I can't remember if I've seen you in the Facebook group or not, but I'm certainly a lot of folks. It's hard to keep everyone sorted. Steven is probably about the Australia thing. Man, I shipped the Noob Spiro guys some stuff. Holy cow, is that expensive. I sent them like a hat and a t-shirt and one of these guys. And yeah, it's really expensive to send stuff to Australia. Okay, so why don't you come to, who is this? Ivan, Key Largo once a month to teach a class here. I don't travel for courses. I used to travel for courses a lot when I was starting, and now I'm just too lazy to. I just don't travel for courses anymore. Chris Simpson, are there any CO2 or O2 tables I recommend? I recommend something different than your traditional O2 and CO2 tables, and that is discussed in depth during the 28-day Freediving Transformation program that I was just referencing. I go over, I've got 3 specific breath holding exercises that I do, and they are not your traditional O2 or CO2 tables, but that's all explained in depth, more than you probably ever wanted to hear about in that 28-day transformation program. That's the one that Michael, he bought it earlier last week, and he was talking about it. Yeah, no, you don't have to do that stuff, but I've been teaching freediving classes for 10 years, way before I had any of these online classes. So I mean, like, you know, the freediving courses are set so that you can walk in, and then I'll do everything in the class. But I have been including some of these courses in my, I've been including some of these online courses for my students that sign up for the in-person courses. It helps because they get access to a lot of material beforehand. All right, any other questions? If so, I'm going to be wrapping this up early because my voice is starting to go. For those of you that are here, I'm just curious, was the video been choppy the whole time? Ian said that it was. I've had a lot of technical issues, and I rebooted everything, and I changed, and my settings got reset, so I haven't gone through and tweaked them like I did before. So I'm curious if that was just a one-off with Ian, or if you guys said that the video was choppy the whole time. What would I recommend to someone that wants to start freediving before taking a course? Simple. First off, I absolutely would recommend you go to freedivingsafety.com and process all of that material. That freedivingsafety.com is basically, it's a free course, and it's as if you took a camera and you stuck it in the back of my classroom when I went over the entire safety portion of the course. Because that's exactly what I did. I took the camera that I'm filming me right now, I stuck it in the laundry room, which is my classroom, and I got right where I sit in my class, and I taught the entire safety program, right? So basically, it's everything that you would get if you sat in on a real class with me for safety, and I'm actually in the pool teaching how to do the rescues and all that sort of stuff. There's so many needless fatalities in the sport because people don't understand the risks that they're subject themselves to. One of the reasons I created freedivingsafety.com, for a lot of reasons, but there was a situation 10, 15 years ago where a student signed up for a freediving class because he was excited to learn how to be safe, and then he died freediving before he could get to the class. Because just because you sign up for the class doesn't mean you automatically become safe, right? So I like this idea of, you know, I'm actually having a lot of freediving instructors, even from different agencies, that part of their sign-up process is they say, awesome, I'm glad you're taking the course with blah, blah, blah. I recommend before you get here, at least go watch these videos so you at least learn how to be safe. And then once you get to the course, then I'll, you know, teach you even more. So I would say, you know, the best things you can do is go through the freedivingsafety.com so that you can at least learn to be safe. And again, that's free. The other thing I would recommend is check your equalization technique, and we can do that really simply. So many people that take a freediving class get stuck at 15 to 30 feet, right? So many people. And it's because they're using the wrong method of equalization. And so you can check right now. So whoever asked me this question, I don't know if you equalize fine or not, but we're going to find out. If you struggle to equalize between 15 and 30 feet when you're spearfishing or freediving, if you notice that it's hard to equalize on the way down, but as soon as you turn around and start to head up, you can equalize no problem, I know exactly what's causing that. And so we're just going to confirm that. So what I want you to do, for everyone that's watching, let's just find out if you're a good equalizer or, I hate to say bad equalizer, but doing it the wrong way equalizer. Put your hand on your stomach, pinch your nose, and I want you to equalize 5 times in a row fast. Right? When you saw me do it, watch. you can see the the throat's moving. If when you do it, you feel your chest moving like this, right? See my chest moving? So the idea is pinch your nose, put your hand on your stomach. If you feel your stomach flexing each time, that means you're doing a Valsalva, and that's why you're getting stuck. So if you feel your stomach clenching every time you equalize, you're equalizing using the wrong method, and that's why you're getting stuck at 15 feet. So when I'm done with this, which can be pretty soon because my voice is going, I'll put a link to I've got an online course that teaches the correct way to equalize via Frenzel. If you're not equalizing right, you're gonna be messed up. And most freediving classes, they don't have enough time to teach that in the course. So that would be my recommendation. The third recommendation is the 28-day transformation program. It's going to teach you, it teaches you how to train for freediving. And I'll tell you, most freediving courses do not teach you how to train after you leave the course. Now, the freediving courses are great because you're going to learn, you know, technique and entry and breathing, and they're awesome. But, I mean, let's put it this way. I feel like I have a pretty thorough course. I think I'm known for having a thorough course. My entry three-day course spends very little time on training after you leave the course. Right? Because I just got too much other stuff to do. So most courses don't really get into that. So if you were to take the 28-day freediving transformation program, you're going to learn even more than my intermediate students get on how to train. And what a better way to get ready for your class than by training for it. Now you're going to go in that class, you're going to be rocking and rolling, right? Then you're going to learn, you know, then, you know, the instructor is going to teach you all the things, and you're going to, you know, learn about the entry and the breathing and all these other things, and you're going to perform even better. That is a long-winded answer to that question. I'm going to look at a couple of these. And I may not be able to answer them all because, as you can tell, my voice is going for sure. All right, what's up, Kelsey? Kelsey's with Florida Freedivers. I was actually going to call you guys. I don't know if you're still here, Kelsey. I've got to deal with stuffing 1,000 bags. I'm doing the bags for Blue Wild, and I'm like, oh my gosh, like you guys used to do that. That's going to be a lot more of a pain in the butt than I think it is. I never actually thought about it until recently, and I've got all the bags, and I'm like, oh my God. I was actually going to call you guys to see how the heck you did that. I've got a feeling I'm going to have to just do it at the show and then just bribe a bunch of people to help me. All right, well, look, no, thank you, Kelsey. I'm happy to do that. It's always jokingly say it's my job. So yeah, look, I'm going to wrap this thing up. I'm starting to, right? So I'll be back tomorrow, Thursday, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I'll be discussing the 3 biggest myths in freediving. You know, because people always say things like, oh, Ted, I'd love to go freediving, but I can only hold my breath for 30 seconds. And I feel like I'm going to die. My ears, when I get to the bottom of the pool, they feel like my head's going to explode, right? Or like, I'm just a normal human. You get freedivers are superhuman. I'm just a normal one, right? And so address kind of all of that sort of stuff as well as be answering your questions. So here's what I'll ask of you guys. If you guys have sat through all of this, right, you must really like freediving if you're interested in listening to me talk about freediving. If you like the show, if you support the show and what I'm doing, I have one simple thing that you can do as soon as you turn this off that will absolutely help this show. You know, the show's new. And a lot of people watch it. I've had some issues because I was sick. That you know, when I'm stopping and starting, that of course affects the viewership. And I've got Blue Wallet coming up next week, so I might have to take a couple days off next week. But if you enjoy the show, if you like what I'm doing, the single best thing you can do is when you shut this thing down, is two things. One, hit the share button. But more than that, because when you just hit the share button, it just shows up on the screen. You know, they just see this video of me talking. They don't know who the hell I am. But if you hit the share button and take the time to explain, hey, this guy, right, Ted, the Freedive Live, he's awesome, you know, I learned all this stuff. Like if you just take the time to put, I mean, because your buddies, they don't know who the hell I am, but if you tell them that this show is awesome and it's worth your time, that will make them watch the show, right? So if you support me, you want to help me out, that's how you do it. Share it. Tell people about the show. Tell them that it's worth their time, because a lot of people, they don't know who the hell I am. I'm just some guy talking on the screen at him. All right, so that's what you can do. When I shut this thing down, give me about 5 minutes, and I'm going to put the links in the post. Well, I'll be going over, you know, the links that I mentioned, the courses that I mentioned, and I'm hoping to get my first survey response, right? So I'm going to put a survey on there. Like I said, if you guys can go fill out that survey, super simple, it's a couple questions. And the questions I'm interested in are, you know, what's your favorite part of the show? And then I just want your feedback. There's a big section. What do you want from the show? What do you want? I mean, what better way to ask than you guys? You're the one watching the show. I want to do what you guys want. I don't want to do what I want. I want to do what you want. Right? So that's a way for you guys to tell me what you want. And if you live in the United States, sorry, Noob Spiro guys, if you live in the United States and you fill out your address, I will ship you some freedivingsafety.com stickers. Right? So that's it. I hope you guys enjoyed the show. I will be back tomorrow. Hopefully my voice will be a little better, but I'm getting better every day. All right, die safe out there. It's not even that hard, especially when you can go to freedivingsafety.com and learn for free. How to not kill yourself.